Hello, 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 everybody. How are you doing? Pastor Mackenzie Cambisi coming your way. Here we go on our final day of radical forgiveness, total freedom through total forgiveness. I am very much excited as we get into our very final presentation on forgiveness. The subject does not end, but we have to move on a little bit as we do these things of God. And so I'm going to deal today with leadership and forgiveness, leadership and forgiveness. And the simple definition of leadership is influence. Whenever you have influence over anyone, you are a leader. And so if you are a parent, if you are a sister, if you are a sibling, if you are a manager, if you are a pastor, if you are a deacon, if you are an elder, if you are a community organizer, you are a leader. And so I just want us to get into this thing and talk about it and encourage somebody who is extremely in these areas. How do I deal with forgiveness as a leader? One thing I've discovered is that power is a powerful blessing. Power is a blessing in the right hands of, when it's in the right hands. And power is a dangerous weapon when it's in the wrong hands. And whenever you have power, there is, the Bible puts it this way, to whom much is given, much is required. And what that means is that there has to be an accountability that comes along with the power that you have. So as a leader, every person created in the image of God is a leader. You are leading in some sphere at some time. You may be leading your children. You may be leading your siblings. You may be leading in a company. You may be leading. Leadership is everywhere. We just vary in our capacity to handle that which we handle. And for many leaders, they are below their potential because they are not aware that they are the leaders that we've been waiting for. So I want to talk to you, and the principles I'm going to share with us, you can apply them in any setting of leadership that you find yourself in. Because it has to be relevant, it has to be practical, and it has to be biblical. I truly do believe that this is a very sensitive area. In fact, I think I'm going to devote at some point a month on leadership. We may not do it every day, but I want to get into that leadership thing because leadership matters. Leadership matters. And I'll tell you this one thing that I believe about leadership. Leadership, it is so important because nothing happens without leadership. Nothing happens without leadership. Nothing happens without leadership. Nothing happens in your life. Nothing happens in your home. Nothing happens on your job. Nothing happens in your country. Nothing happens in your church without leadership. I'll give you seven reasons why leadership is so powerful. It's so powerful because nothing happens without leadership. Nothing, absolutely nothing happens without leadership. Number two, nothing changes without leadership. Leadership matters. That's why the devil is so invested in destroying leaders. And all of us are leaders. And that's why, because the devil knows that nothing changes without leadership. And so leadership is a threat to the wrong people because leadership changes things. Nothing changes without leadership. And nothing develops without leadership. Leadership is so powerful because without it, nothing develops. Okay, nothing develops. When you think about it, when I come to your home, you know, children would have never learned how to walk if there was no leader in their life. Someone who guided them, who encouraged them, who nudged them and sang songs so that they could attempt crawling or attempt standing and attempt walking. So nothing develops without leadership. Number four, nothing improves without leadership. Nothing improves without leadership. There are so many organizations, and when I say organization, you are an organization as a person. You are an organization yourself. Your family is an organization. Your church is an organization. So I want you to think of leadership in the very organic way of it. Leadership is not just a few men or women with an inner suit in front of you with a mic. No, leadership is anyone who has influence. Leadership is influence. So if you have influence on anybody, or anybody has influence on you, they are a leader, you are a leader. All right? So seven things that makes leadership so powerful. Nothing happens without leadership. All right? Nothing happens without leadership. Nothing changes without leadership. Nothing changes without leadership. Nothing develops without leadership. Nothing develops without leadership. Nothing improves without leadership. All right? Nothing improves without leadership. Nothing is corrected without leadership. It takes a leader to correct some things. So in your family, if there are some things that are happening in your life, if there are some things that are happening that you don't like, what you need is a leader. Leadership corrects things. Leadership corrects things. That's why it takes guts for you to be a leader. Okay? All of us are leaders. The difference is you have got leaders who are not courageous. You have got leaders who are not strong. You have got leaders who are not willing. In your own family, if you don't stand up as a leader, your own children will become something else. So leadership is needed. Leadership is extremely needed everywhere. So without leadership, nothing advances. Nothing advances without leadership. Okay? So leadership is extremely important. And the seventh thing that I got for you is that nothing succeeds without leadership. Nothing succeeds without leadership. We are always being led directly or indirectly. We are always being led directly or indirectly, and we are always leading indirectly or indirectly. So I want to get into this thing. Leadership is very important. I'm telling you, the moment you give yourself permission to lead, you're going to discover that there's so much in you. There's a world that's waiting for your guidance, for your leadership. And leaders fail. Leaders fail. Leaders fail. Leaders fail. Leaders fail because they are trying to make something happen. They are trying to change something. They are trying to develop something. They are trying to improve something. And in that process, our leaders fail. Leaders fail. And the greatest, in order for you to see that you're forgiven a leader. And when I say leader, I want you to think of leadership. It may be your husband, it may be your wife, it may be your children, it may be your son. I mean, anyone who has influence on you is a leader. And leaders fail. Let's put it right there. Leaders fail. Leaders fail. In fact, if you know of any leader who has never failed, you should never be under them. Because anyone who has never failed never understands how it feels like to fail. And that's why leaders fail. Leaders fail so that they can have an experiential knowledge of leading others. Yeah, you gotta know, because what I've discovered is if you don't experience what I experience, then you are not going to be patient with me. You think I'm weak, you think I'm playing, but when you go through it, God gives you the humility for you to understand others. All right. So now forgiveness, when it comes to a leader, forgiveness and leadership comes in the best way, or the best picture of forgiveness to a leader is restoration. Okay. In other words, you as a leader, if you have fallen and you want to know if you have been forgiven, it will always show in the form of restoration. So whether it's leadership at your home, the forgiveness that comes in. So if someone in your home who is a leader fails you and you forgive them, it will only be understood that they are forgiven by you restoring them to the place that they were before they fell. That's the best way in understanding forgiveness with the leadership. Okay. So Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this moment. Please be with us now as we discuss this important subject of leadership and forgiveness. We may be the one who needs to forgive. We may be the one who needs to be forgiven. And we may be both at the same time. So please help us take away the guilt and shame and bring in the desire to be better in each and every one of us. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. And so when you look at it now, Galatians chapter 6, verse 1, it reads this way. It says, "Dear brothers and sisters, if anyone If another believer is overcome by some sin, you who are godly should gently and humbly help that person back onto the right path. Okay, but listen to this, and be careful not to fall. Right? Somebody fails. If someone is overcome with some sin, God is saying, you who are godly, you got to be in a godly place, state where you are, but with humility, help that person back into the right path. But whilst you are helping a person who has failed, be careful that you don't get into the same problem that is there. So individuals who possess leadership positions in ministry are all human beings. You know, everybody is a human being with personal shortcomings and weaknesses. Okay, so we want to get in and talk about it. Okay, then how do we restore a fallen leader as a form of forgiveness? All right, it's amazing when you look through scripture that it matters for us to restore fallen leaders. If your husband has failed, it matters for you to restore him into his leadership role. And forgiveness will only show in the form of restoration when it comes to leadership. Being a leader is very hard. It's painful because some of the things that you have to lead as a husband, as a father, or as a mother, or as a big sister, are things that you may be struggling with yourself. But at the same time, because you have influence over others, you still have to function even when you are struggling in the areas that you have to lead somebody. All right, so let me get into it and talk to us about it. So how do we formulate forgiveness for leadership in the form of restoration? It is important that when you look through the Bible, give you seven individuals, leaders, who went through this restoration process. Adam was restored by God from disobedience. You all know Adam did the most heinous crime that could ever be done by anyone created by God, and God restored him from disobedience. Abraham, he was restored from lying. You remember, he was lying, and he even lied on his wife, and yet God restored him. Jacob was restored from deception. You remember him deceiving his brother, that, you know what, gave him a bowl of soup, and he took away his birthright. And thank God that he was restored from deception. Moses was restored from murder. You remember in Exodus chapter 2, he killed an Egyptian. He ran for his life. And I want to challenge you right now, whilst you're thinking about leaders, what would have happened if Adam was not restored from disobedience? What would have happened if Abraham was not restored from lying? What would have happened to Jacob as a leader if he was not restored from deception? What would have happened to Moses if he was not restored from murder? And David, you know David, he was restored from adultery. He was a leader, and yet he failed, and God restored him from adultery. And Peter, what about Peter? You know Peter, he's in the Bible, you walked in the water, you know him, and yet he denied Jesus three times, and God restored him from denial. And there was a man in the book of Acts called John Mark. John Mark was restored in the book of Acts chapter 13. That's where you find him. He was restored from abandonment. In other words, he abandoned Apostle Paul because he did not want to go back. John called it quits and went back to Jerusalem. He didn't want to go where Paul was sailing and going, but he was restored from abandonment. Leaders are human beings. They make mistakes. They have weaknesses. They have blind spots. And when you forgive a leader, true forgiveness to a leader. And when I say leader, I'm not talking just of your pastor. I'm talking of a leader in your family. I'm talking of your supervisor on the job. I'm talking about, and when you restore these people, some of them, you got to restore your respect of them in your mind. All right, in your mind. And this is very critical when it comes to family. I'll just use an example. When a husband fails or a wife fails, if you don't restore them back to their original husband or wife position in your head, it becomes difficult to be submissive to them. Okay, it becomes difficult to respect them. It becomes difficult to love them. You know where I'm going with this. it becomes easy for the root of bitterness to grow. So it is very, very important that whilst you are not married to an angel, whilst you are not, your mother is not an angel, your children are not an angel, when you forgive people, it matters that in your mind, when they are leaders, you restore them. In your thinking of them, you must think of them as leaders. Okay, I've been in ministry for a while, and one thing I'll tell you about leadership is that the enemy wins so many times in the church because when people are growing and there's a conflict, most people they will throw the baby and the bathwater away. No forgiveness. Okay, no forgiveness. Oh no, man, you know what? We had a difference, we had a conflict, and that's it. And anyone who cannot restore you in their minds to be their pastor after having a conflict with them, that person is living in the land of unforgiveness, and there's nothing good that comes from a place where leaders are not restored to their position. First of all, in our thinking, it matters for you to do that. So there are mothers who have got children who have messed up. You know, they've messed up. That doesn't mean that your child is not a leader. You need in your mind to restore them to that leader position in order for you to benefit from the leadership gift that they have. So it's very, very important for us to understand that it matters that God, the Bible is a story of restored leaders. The Bible is the whole story from Genesis all the way to Revelation. It's a story of restored leaders because they were forgiven, and the form of expression of that forgiveness came through their restoration. So it matters, my friend. I want to talk to you right now. I don't know who is the leader in your life. It may be your husband. It may be your wife. It may be your child. It may be your supervisor. It may be your manager. It may be your pastor. Whoever has influence on you, who have let you down, hurt you, and you forgive them, if they have influence on you, which makes them a leader to you, it calls for you to have a heart that is willing to restore them to a place of influence again. Let me tell you something, my friends. Leaders are so powerful and important to God that the Bible, the only thing that God could do with leaders in the Bible is restore them. You know, God could have called somebody else when Jonah ran away, but the Bible says God spoke to Jonah again. God restored Jonah. God could have simply said to Peter, "You have denied me 3 times. Get out of here. I'm going to find a new person to come and replace you." But no, Peter had to repent. And Jesus told him, "When you have repented, feed my lamb." Why? Because it takes so much investment in a leader. I want you to understand this, my friends. It matters because of the 7 things I gave you. Leaders change things. And when God invests in a leader, there's a purpose for that leader. And I want you to understand that every one of us has a leadership calling upon our lives. And when we have a heart that refuses to restore people in our minds to their position of influence, we literally block the blessing that God has for us through people. God is going to bless you through a person. And that person is not perfect. Leaders fail. You fail. And you are a leader. I've told you right now. You are a leader. You know, sometimes the problem we have is believing that you are a leader. You are a leader. If you are a mother of one child, you are a leader. If you're an auntie to a niece, you are a leader. If there's someone that you tell what to do and they do because you have influence on them, you are a leader. And when leaders fail, the expression of forgiveness on leadership is restoration. All right? Thank God Adam was restored from disobedience. Thank God Abraham was restored from lying. Thank God Moses was restored from murder. Thank God Jacob was restored from deception. Thank the Lord Peter was restored from denial. And John Mark was restored from abandonment. And David, who wrote most of the Psalms that we love to sing and to read, "The Lord is my shepherd." Thank God he was restored from adultery. Let me tell you something. There's so much that could have never been given to the world were those leaders not restored because God forgave them? So I want to ask you a question. What are you hindering from becoming a blessing to you and your family and your sphere of influence? Which leader are you holding down and refusing to restore? So much so that you're missing out on the blessing because of that. Now, if you are the leader who hurt or who failed and who messed up and you are forgiven, I want to talk to you because as a leader, you are going to make things happen. And some moments you're going to fail those that you lead. If you are the one and you are a leader, whether you are a mother, okay, you are a mother, you've lost the respect of your children because things didn't go well, you failed somewhere. And as a leader, you are trying to recoup and to reestablish your place again as a mother. Okay, how do I fix it when I, here are a few things I want to share, seven things I want to share with you if you are the leader who needs to be restored as a form of forgiveness. Number one, I'll put this one, then apply it well. Be regular, offer regular presence. In order for you now to show your repentant self as a leader who is being restored, you need to show a regular presence. What does that mean? If I was talking to the church in the church language, it'll be attend worship service regularly. Okay? If you're a leader who has failed in the church and you want to be restored and you are being considered for restoration, you must attend service regularly. So if it's in your family, you as a leader, as a mother, as a parent, as a father, you have failed, you must offer your presence on a regular basis. In other words, there must be interaction with the people that you have influence on that you failed as they in order for you to regain your place again. Running away from people, avoidance is not going to get it done. All right. And the second thing that is very, very important is this one. Communicate about the people that you lead that you failed positively. All right. So if you're a mother and you're falling out with your child and you're a leader and you want, you know, it's leadership and forgiveness. So you want to, how do I develop forgiveness between me, I'm a parent, and my child that I've had an issue with? I must learn to communicate positively about the child that I've had a conflict with. See, when you're a leader, you need to understand it takes more from you because you have influence on the other. If you have influence on anybody, you need to get to that place. If it's in the church, learn to communicate about the church positively. Okay? You cannot be a restored leader when you are negative about the church. You cannot be a restored mother when you are negative about the children that you had a conflict with. You cannot, even on your job, if you are going to be restored to a place of influence or you are going to restore somebody to a place of influence, positivity matters. Positivity matters. So it's important for you to communicate positively about the person that you had influence on that you fell out on. All right. And you know, there has to be participation faithfully. Participate in engagement. When you are a leader, one thing about leadership that I've discovered, the very thing that you need, which is your confidence for you to get things done, when things go wrong, if you are not careful, your confidence can turn into pride. So there are some parents who have hurt their children and they cannot go back and reconnect because of pride. So, you know, I'm not going to come and talk to you or, make sure that we are together. You know, no, I'm not going to do that because if I do that, then I lose who I am. No, leadership. Let me tell you something. When God has given you influence over anything, nobody can take that away. When you read the Bible, you discover one thing that I've seen in the Bible. That's why the Bible has got prophets. You know, you've got false prophets and true prophets. Have you noticed something? They are all prophets. Even the ones who walked away from God, they are still considered. Let me tell you something. The call of God on your life as a leader is irrefutable. Do you know what that means? It means God is not going to take away the call on your life because you messed up. When God gives you influence, that influence, you either use it or you abuse it. Because you cannot lead without influence. You cannot be a mother without influence on your kids. You cannot be a grandmother without influence on your grandchildren. You cannot be a pastor without an influence on your members. So here's what happens. That influence, you can either use it or you can abuse it. That it's one of the two. Even as a parent, you can use your influence well or you can abuse your influence. All right. So when things go wrong, and they will go wrong, if you're a leader who is leading, real leading leaders will always have conflicts in their lives. Because like I told you, you know, leaders change things and people don't like change. Leaders make things happen. And there's some people wish for things to happen, but when they really happen, every true leader will get punished for changing what the people loved and they were yearning could not be changed. All right. So it's very, very important when you get into that. So it matters. Restoration as a form of doing things is very, very important. All right. So it's very important. And when you want to restore a leader into your life or restore a leader into your organization, evaluation is very, very important. What does that mean, Pastor? It means you must assess the behavior of the leader that you are trying to restore back into your life or restore back into your organization. Okay. That is very, very, very important. James chapter 2:22, it reads this way. You see that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. There has to be an evaluation where anybody that you are restoring back into your life, there must be an evaluation assessing their behavior to see that during your time of fallout, there was something that actually happened to that the other person confirms that they saw the light and they want to re-engage with you. Okay. The second thing that you do when you are restoring someone between the head, it starts here. Anyone who cannot lead you in your mind, they cannot lead you in your life. Anybody that you don't think of as a leader, even they cannot be your leader. Okay. That is extremely important. Anyone that you cannot be your leader. Okay. So it starts here. Okay. In other words, if Jesus is not my master here, it doesn't matter what Jesus is doing in the world. It will not mean much to me. So that's why the Bible says, be transformed by the renewal of your mind. It is right here where leadership happens. The day thinking of me as a leader in my family is the day that I lose my role. So it's very important. So you gotta, there gotta be evaluation of the behavior of the person. I'm talking of forgiveness and leadership now. There has to be determination. Okay. There must be a decide to restore. Decide to restore. When a leader has hurt you and you're falling out, it's going to take determination. It's gonna take you and I to make it a matter of decision that we can restore that person. And the same is true with our families. There are so many people in your families. There's so much greatness in your family. And because there are so many people in your family that are hurting and running organizations everywhere, and if you don't decide to restore them in your head, you are the only person who is not benefiting from the greatness that is within your own family. All right. And the other thing is communication. Communication. There got to be some meeting. Talking, dialoguing. Hey, we fell out on this one, so what are we going to do? You got to talk about it. Forgiveness in leadership, there has to be communication. Is it an easy thing? No, it's not, because pride comes in the way. But it always matters to communicate and communicate and communicate. I remember churches that I've pastored in my life, some of them can testify. You know, sometimes I could just apologize in the midst of service. You know, I just apologize. Hey, if I've done anything, you know, that whatever, please, I'm sorry, forgive me. And some people have issues with that. How do you just ask for forgiveness? Well, I know what forgiveness is. I know what forgiveness is. If you are a leader, your decision, your most well-meaning decision can be misunderstood because people always look at what you do from their point of view. Okay. Same thing with your own children. Your own children can see you as a dictator. Not that you are a dictator. You are looking out for them, but being a child and looking at what you do and what you see is not what they see. But when they have their own children, then they understand that you are looking out for them. So communication is very important if you're going to restore someone into a place of leadership on your mind. And information. Information is very important. You know, let's talk about it. What happened? You know, what happened? What, and how can I help you for it not to happen again? You know, I have a passion for leadership. Leadership is one of the gifts that I truly do believe God has put on my life. And whenever leadership is abused, it does something to me. It really does, because leaders have so much power. Has it ever dawned on you that we talk of the Holocaust, we talk of Hitler, you know, how Hitler made German for them to literally go after the Jews the way they did. You know, what would have happened if this guy chose to use his influence positively? Osama bin Laden. Osama bin Laden was the leader of a terrorist group that literally ravaged. Right now, whenever you go to the airport and you have to take off your shoes for you to get through the metal detectors, it's because there was a leader called Osama bin Laden who chose evil over using his influence positively. All of us, we're at the mercy of leaders. The Bible says, listen, when a good leader comes around, people flourish. When a bad leader comes around, people run away. Has it ever dawned on you that when you read the Old Testament in the Bible, for those of you people of faith, the Bible says when the king was right, Israel did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. When the king was evil, the people went astray and they left the God of their fathers. Only one person. A leader's influence can shift a nation to do right. A leader's influence can shift a nation to do wrong. I am here in the United States. We are at the crossroads right now because of the former president we had. Okay, the former president we had, the country was something else. We have almost 500,000 people dying from the COVID-19 because the former president thought it was a joke. And we have a new president who came in, and just from his behavior and the way he does, the numbers are going down in the United States of America. I mean, he is pushing, testing, pushing vaccines, putting plans together. Leaders make things happen. And the same is true with you and your family. If your family is at a place where everybody thinks nothing is happening, it's because there's a leader in your family who is not stepping up, or there's a leader in your family that you haven't restored in your mind so that they can make things happen within your own vicinity. Leaders are very important. And here's one thing I want to say to you. You cannot, as a leader, all of us are leaders, okay? And here's where the kicker is. You cannot be a good leader when you are not a good follower. Every leader is balanced by his followership. Okay? What does that mean? What that means is I can't just be pastor who tells people what to do and I don't follow people. Okay? It's a give and take situation. For me to be a good leader, you must be in the place of the people that you're leading. And the only way to do that is you cannot be a good leader without you being a good follower. Parents out there, you are leaders. It matters for you to listen to your kids. It really does. They don't know as much as you do, but the principle of listening, in order for you to instill it in them, they must also confirm and confess that you are a good listener to them. So many leaders do not want, none of us is indispensable. None of us is indispensable. But some of us are irreplaceable. Okay, as a leader, you can work so hard and become a person who is, all of us, none is indispensable, but some leaders are irreplaceable. So in whatever sphere of influence you have, do the best you can so that, my friend, you become irreplaceable. Oh yeah, nobody is indispensable, but some leaders, a few of us, are irreplaceable. Okay, you can tell places what once a good leader is gone, a church is closed. You know, once a good leader leaves, cities fall apart. Once a good leader is gone, countries fall apart because good leadership matters. So, my friends, it matters if you, every one of us is a leader, because leadership, you know, in its basic form, is influence. So if you have influence on anybody, and I'm saying to you, the best expression of forgiveness to a leader, Minister Daphne, is a restoration. All right? Restoration matters to a leader. And so the next thing, so you have information, let's talk about what happened, and then there has to be allowing the fallen leader to serve. You're going to allow, that's activation. Allow the fallen leader in your life, in your family, on the job, in your church, they got to serve. Because leaders lead. If you have a child in your family who is a leader, and you know they are a leader, and if you don't give them leadership opportunities, okay, if you take away all their leadership opportunities as a form of punishing them for whatever they've done wrong, they don't get better as a leader. Let me tell you something. All of us are leaders, but the most misunderstood thing in human history is leadership. Isn't that funny? Because all of us want leadership to be important when we are in front. And yet, the truth of the matter is, you will always be following somebody, and you always be leading somebody in your life. And you are more blessed when you are aware that you are leading, or you are aware that you are being led, and you are great leading, and you are great following. It feeds the balance for a leader. So may the Lord bless us and keep us. Leaders make mistakes. Please, they do. They really make mistakes. They do make mistakes. People love the benefits of leadership, but very few people understand the isolation and loneliness of being a leader. And leaders make mistakes. Thank God that when Adam and Eve failed, God restored them. If he was not restored, I can only imagine where we would have been. But thank God that Abraham was restored. He was lying. That guy could lie on a dime. But thank God he restored him from lying to become the father of the faithful. Thank God Moses, he killed an Egyptian. He was a murderer. And one day the bush started burning and God started talking and God sent him back on the mission. He was restored from murder. Even King David, he was restored from adultery. David didn't just commit adultery. David killed the husband of the wife that he committed adultery. Then he married the wife. Oh my goodness. You're talking of heinous, hurtful, painful leadership skills. And yet God restored him. Even Nebuchadnezzar was restored by God. All right. Leadership matters. There is no perfect leader. Only God is the perfect leader. There's no perfect leader because all leaders are in process. Okay, every leader is in process of being perfected. Leadership is an on-the-job call. All right, leadership is about decision making, decisions that you make on the dime. Thank God if it's some of those decisions that you've been thinking about. But most of the decisions you have to make as a leader, they come right there. That's why leaders make mistakes. And when they do, and it's amazing that everybody knows what a good leader must be. Let me tell you something. Above every quality that of any leadership book that you have ever read about leadership, let me tell you something. True leaders are true human. A true leader is truly human. And when you are a leader, the greatest temptation of true leadership is people forcing you to be something else that you are not, and then expecting you to understand everything that they are, which they deny you. So when God gives you an opportunity to lead, and he does, and God gives you an opportunity to lead, you need to understand that God is not turning you into a god. You always give what you are. True leadership comes from being, not doing. True leaders, they do because they are, and they are, and they always give what they are. True leadership is not about doing, it's about being. So even in your own family, it's not about telling everybody what to do, it's who you are. People may not listen to what you say, but people will always do what you do. So may the Lord bless us and keep us. This is our final discussion on forgiveness. If someone is going to lead you, listen, the Bible is full of men who fell and they got up. Don't be the person who punishes leaders. Oh, if you fail, oh, that's it. No. If it was not about restoration when it comes to leadership forgiveness, then the Bible would not mean anything. Because most of the people in the Bible who are leaders, and some of them wrote books of the Bible. You know, Paul himself, the one who wrote 14 books of the New Testament. This brother was just something else. He was a murderer. And yet God restored. God specializes in restoring people. There's a song that I like listening to. The guy who wrote that song is a personal friend of mine. And the song is God Restores. Whenever you hear that song, God Restores, is a personal friend of mine. We passed it together at Madison Mission in Down, Alabama. He wrote that song when his father and mother divorced. And he was in the pain of that dark moment. God led him to write that song, God Restores. So I want to challenge you, my friends, to say as a leader, as a mother, God will restore you when you fail on that influential position you have. If you are a pastor, if you're a deacon, if you are whatever stuff it is, every one of us is a leader. If you are an auntie who has let down your nieces on their birthdays, you promised you didn't deliver, that hurt, that's leadership failure. I want you to understand that you can, God restores and God can get you to a place where God can make things work. So may the Lord bless you. May you embrace forgiveness. May you accept forgiveness and may you extend forgiveness to leaders. They need it because the enemy is after them, because the devil doesn't want leaders to make things happen. He doesn't want leaders to change things. He doesn't want leaders to develop things. He doesn't want leaders to improve things. He doesn't want leaders to correct things. He doesn't want leaders to advance things. And he doesn't want leaders to make some things succeed. Without leadership, this 7 will never happen. Your family needs you. If you are a leader, if you had given up on your sphere of influence, I want you to know that it's God who gave you that sphere of influence. When he comes again, let it not be heard of you. Let it not be heard of me when he asks the question, where is the talent I gave you? May it never be your excuse to say, Lord, I hid them because the people didn't believe me. Lord, I hid them because I didn't look like I was the one that they needed. It's God who put it in you. When you fail, acknowledge your wrong, seek forgiveness from God, and pray that God will send somebody with favor to restore you to the position of influence where you can function as God has called you. Blessings on you, my friends, as you lead in your home, as you lead in your church, as you lead in your community, wherever you have sphere of influence, you are a leader. And your greatest blessing is to extend restoration to others and to accept restoration from others. Blessings on you. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this journey that we've had on forgiveness. We pray in a very special way for a tender heart toward our leaders as they are human, as they fail, and they fail and they are human so that we are comfortable within their leaders. For Lord, if it was an angel, they would not know how we feel. And we are grateful that, Lord, we do have a high priest in Jesus Christ who is touched with it every point of our infirmities. We thank you, Lord, that you know how it feels like to be human and you know how to overcome everything that human beings go through, and you are willing to do life alongside with us. So bless everyone on this platform. Bless the many who will watch this in so many different countries. And I pray that leaders get restored and your work keeps on moving, because God, you are about restoring leaders. So have your own way in our homes, have your own way on our jobs, have your own way in our countries, have your own way in our churches. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen and amen again. Blessings on you, my friends. Expect some other Facebook Live. I may take a break just for a little bit, but we're going to come back, because I believe when you are better, other people get better. I believe that this is the day which the Lord has made. This is the year, and you must use all your gift to his glory. For my friend, you are here for a reason. You are here for a purpose. And I am here. Thank you for the opportunity to be your coach and to be your mentor as we progress on purpose. Go to my YouTube channel. Please subscribe. Some of you haven't. If you have, thank you. If you haven't, go check out Pastor Mackenzie Kambizi, Progress on Purpose. And I'm going to be putting a lot of videos whilst I'm off Facebook on my YouTube channel. Or you can go to Anchor app, and I have my podcast there, Pastor Mackenzie Kambizi. You are going to be blessed. Whichever way I can be of help, please get in touch with me. Go to kambizi.com and fill out a form, and we'll talk about it. Blessings on you. Thank you so much for this journey. I'll be back. Blessings on you.